Just a few little Kickstarter things here. Please notice there are some announcements in the bulletin. And by the by, you are going to have to do things old school this week. There isn't going to be anything up on the monitors there. So you're going to have to get out. This is called a hymnal. This song has pages in it and there's songs. So anyway, you're going to have to use some of that. And also what is on your bulletin for some different things. Okay? Other than that, one of the things for a prayer request for us to think about is Bob Pearson told me that his daughter is doing pretty well, but there is still prayers for her complete recovery. So, I think that's what I needed to tell you, right? Well, good. We're talking about, and I said, this is sort of like George Burns and Gracie Allen. So, anyway, let's focus our hearts and minds on worship.
Good morning. Will you stand as you are able and join in the call to worship as printed in your bulletin? Jesus began his ministry to the world, led by the Spirit into the wilderness. In those 40 days and in that place, Jesus was faced with hunger, doubt, and temptation. Jesus left the wilderness faithful and obedient to God, rejoicing in the one whom he trusted. Hour of prayer, and you will find that in your red hymnal on page 496, and we will sing verses 1 and 3. For Christ also suffered for our sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you into God. He was put to death in flesh, but made alive in spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey. When God patiently waited in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight lives were saved through water, and baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. May God bless the reading of this holy word.
Amen.
Now we'll invite the children forward for a moment with Ms. Bobby.
Just to let you know, that was the best part. We can go home now. My son was halfway out the door already. So. However, that brings us to a time of prayer, which is also a very, very important time. Let us spend a moment in silent prayer, bringing forth our joys, our concerns, and our petitions. Mm-hmm. Great God, we come to you thanking you for all the many blessings that you have showered upon us. Help us always to be a thankful people. Great God, we come to you with our petitions, both those we have mentioned aloud and those we live silently in our hearts. Hear our prayers. Great God, we pray for the leaders of our nation. We recognize that we as a nation are in need of your guidance. Great God, we pray for the leaders of our state government. We pray for your guidance for our local leaders. We pray for the safety of all those who are in service to this country. May you be a tangible presence in their lives. We pray for the just and equitable society that Christ proclaimed. Help us to be participants in your gospel. We also pray for the leaders of other nations, that they may be good and just leaders. We pray for the world that all people will work together for the justice that will bring a true peace. Help us to be participants in your gospel. We pray for the leaders of our church. Help us to be participants in your gospel. Great God, in our finiteness, help us to understand your eternity. And now, we come to you understanding that we are unworthy to come before your holy presence, and yet we come confidently because we come to you in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, the one who is the Christ. Renew the rush of the Holy Spirit within us as we pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the book of Mark, chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove upon him. And a voice came from heaven, You are my beloved Son, the one with whom I am well pleased. And the Spirit immediately drove him out to the wilderness. He was in the wilderness for 40 days, tested by Satan. And he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God, saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Our worship will continue with hymn number 525. You can remain seated. We'll understand it by and by, verses 1 and 4.
Please pray with me. May the words of our mouths, the meditations of our hearts, and the works of our hands be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock, our hope, and our redeemer. Amen. Bonjour.
Bonjour.
So, I already said good morning, so I thought I'd try. Guten Morgen or something like that. So, earlier on when we were talking, Robin said she's amazed that they let us both up here at the same time. So anyway, for those of you who may not know this, I am not Pastor Ryan. Sorry about that. I am Gary Vrugink. And I could go through a litany of who I am, but that would be very boring. Let's just say that I am a recovering Calvinist, and by grace, I have been a United Methodist for most of my life. Actually, for this congregation, it's been about 50 years, if I recall correctly. So, which I seldom do. Now, with that in mind, and since it has been a while since I last preached here, once again, a number of people from the congregation have insisted that I add a disclaimer before I start, in case there are some here who are unfamiliar with me. So here goes. The views presented here are not necessarily those of the United Methodist Church or its members. The above-mentioned accept no liability for the content of this sermon or for the consequences of any actions taken on the basis of the information provided, unless that information is subsequently confirmed by the Spirit. Some restrictions may apply, void were prohibited by law, some assembly required, objects in the mirror are closer than they appear, batteries not included. More importantly, I have been told by some that I should keep it short. Nevertheless, I remind you, a famous preacher once said, "My job is to speak, yours to listen. I hope you will not finish before I do." Okay, with that out of the way, let's go over the scriptures. So, Christ's temptation in the desert in the Gospel according to Mark. Three of the four Gospels tell us that after his baptism, Jesus spent time in the wilderness. John's loquacious Jesus, love that word, doesn't have time to be alone. He's got disciples to call and parties to attend, wine to make. But the other three are pretty clear that Jesus needed time to get things in order. At least that is what it seems like he's doing. What kind of Messiah is he going to be? Matthew and Luke describe the conversation in the wilderness, the temptations. They give us some background into the decisions facing Jesus as he launched his ministry. They provide lots of juicy details about what was going on there and lots of debate about the test. Matthew has the devil tempting Jesus to make stones into bread, then to the pinnacle of the temple, and then to a very high mountain. Luke has the devil tempt Jesus to make stones into bread, then to a high place to see all the kingdoms of the world, and then to the pinnacle. But no, it is year B in the lectionary cycle, and we get Mark. Mark, who presents the temptation in the wilderness in two verses, who doesn't itemize the question, who doesn't tell us how strenuous it was. We just get some bullet points in Mark's PowerPoint on Jesus. Item one, Jesus was there for 40 days. Item two, he was tempted by Satan. Note that Mark, the earliest of the written Gospels, which Matthew and Luke use as a template for their Gospels, uses the name Satan, which means the adversary, as the tempter. But how was he tempted by Satan? No time for questions, moving on, item three. He was with the wild beasts. What? What do you mean he was with the wild beasts? No time for questions, moving on. Item four, he was waited upon by angels. Waited on? They brought him meals and such? They mopped his brow and fanned him with big leaves? Or they stood on the edge of the wilderness and tapped their toes and checked their iPhones for texts from Jesus? End of lecture. Okay. What was going on there? Mark says, we don't know. Mark says, it doesn't matter, really, what exactly happened. Mark says the important stuff is there. Back up, he says. Look at the process. Baptism, heavens torn open, gentle spirit like a dove settles, and Jesus's best is blessed, then gentle spirit becomes an irresistible force driving him out into the wilderness. Driving him. Temptation, wild animals, angels. That's all you need to know. But in his brevity, Mark packs a punch with powerful verbs. During Jesus' baptism, Mark writes that the heavens are torn open. He deliberately evokes Isaiah 64, verse 1. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down. The verb tear suggests a violent inbreaking, not a peaceful scene with a bird. With just one word, Mark accomplishes much more with his listeners, showing that Christ fulfills the hopes of the Old Testament. After the brief baptism scene, Mark states that the Spirit drove Jesus into the wilderness, while Luke says Jesus was filled by the Spirit, and Matthew writes the Spirit led him. While Mark may be short on scenes, the words he picks are intriguing. Does being driven by the Spirit mean that Jesus does not enthusiastically embrace this time of testing? Would he have preferred to prepare for his public ministry in a different way? Does he resist going to the wilderness, necessitating a driving force? And of course, the part about the Spirit driving Jesus into the wilderness is preceded by Mark's favorite word, immediately. An adverb he uses as much as the other three gospel writers combined. Mark's next verse encapsulates the entire 40-day period of testing, which both Matthew and Luke spend several verses depicting. As I said before, Mark uses the word Satan, while the other two use the devil. And I am intrigued by Mark's use of Satan. Why Satan? Which means adversary instead of the devil. Satan certainly evokes Job. And maybe that is what Mark is going for. Is the testing like Matthew and Luke, or is it more Job-like? Mark doesn't even say that Jesus fasts. And what is with the wild beasts? We have those beastly moments from time to time, don't we? We find ourselves cast out into a world we aren't ready for, dealing with things which we didn't prepare, wondering if we are going to survive. There are choices to be made, paths to follow, and we are never sure which is right. What will bring us back into the gentle blessing of the Spirit, and what will drive us deeper into conflict with the adversary. And our first thought when we find ourselves in difficult situation is, what did I do wrong? How did I get off track? One wonders if Jesus had those thoughts while stumbling around the wilderness. What did I do wrong? Surely not, we think. He must have known what he was doing. It must have been his idea to go and spend some quiet time before diving into the busy years of his earthly ministry. But then, why does it say the Spirit drove him out? Doesn't that sound like he didn't want to go? Sounds like a punishment. God drove Adam and Eve out of the garden. It sounds like getting rid of something you don't want. Jesus himself would later drive out demons and drive out disease. It was a way of getting obstacles out of the way. Jesus drove out the mourners when he wanted to rescue Jairus' daughter from the grip of death. The Spirit drove him out into the wilderness. The Spirit tore open the heavens and drove him into the wilderness. And in the middle, he was blessed with a gentle presence and loving words. He was tempted in the harsh wilderness for 40 days, and in the midst of it, he was waited on by emissaries of the God who claimed him at the river. Again, there's an echo of our lives that seems to facilitate between moments of love and acceptance and moments of doubt and terror. We seem to be swallowed up in uncertainty, even as we are comforted by blessings of those who love us. Mark says that Jesus tells us to lean into the Spirit, even when it blows us into uncharted territory, even when it seems to be sending us out against our will. Lean into the uncertainty, because the Spirit won't abandon you. And along the way, there will be moments of blessing. Remember them. Cling to them. Let them be sustaining in times of temptation and deprivation. Let those words, "You are my beloved," ring in your ears over the weeping and moans of your own brokenness. And let the gentle Spirit be what drives you and to embrace the suffering of the world to bring healing and wholeness and love. Lean into the Spirit. It won't let you down. And you'll find resources to face whatever may come in the wilderness. And out of this moment, out of this beastly wilderness moment, Jesus comes to announce that the kingdom of God has come near. Really? Where? Here in the non-wilderness world? Or back there? Where is the kingdom nearest to us? Is it when we are safe and happy and everything is easy? Or is it when we are wrestling like Jacob at Jabbok's Ford? That's the invitation of this Lenten series, to feel the depths of love, the depths of presence, even at our most beastly. Amen?
Amen.
Please pray with me. Lord and Shepherd of our journeys in the desert, we come to you during this Lenten season as servants of Jesus Christ. We remember how you liberated Moses and the Israelites. We remember also how you liberated the prophet Elijah in his journey to escape from a corrupt king. Now, in our Lenten journey, we implore your direction, your patience, and your spiritual support. As you sent your angels to care for the Israelites, to the prophet Elijah in his journey, and to Jesus during his 40 days in the desert, send them also to us in our earthly journeys. We ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And now we will be waited upon for our tithes and offerings. Thank you. understanding that on the journey in Lent we can't avoid or detour around the wilderness. It is essential that we hear Jesus call us to repentance. Bless our gifts for your unfinished kingdom work. Remind us as we worship here that this redemption of our lives did not come without a price. Without our own repentance, we can miss the enormity of the gift Jesus gave. Knowing we cannot earn this redemption and forgiveness, this wiping clean of our ledger, we can only hope to reflect. Such grace and compassion in our encounters with others. In Christ's name we pray through the workings of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now, remain standing and join in our hymn. The number in our hymn book is 536, and we will be singing verses 1 and 4 of Precious Name.